So we are going to go into the next program point, which is Hugo Fredrik Korsbeck from Nordnet talking about deploying coherent interfaces and what the hell is that. Please give him a hand.
Oh, about coming in though. Right, so it's a bit loud maybe. Is this better? All right. So I'm going to speak about the exact same thing again, but maybe in another style this time, and then we can compare each other to the talk before. So I'm from Sweden, obviously. So first, my name is Fredrik Korsbeck. I'm usually known as Hugge. I'm 29 years old. I have 46.5 inches. I started working for the TDC Song many years ago, and then back over to Tele2, and now I'm at Nordnet. I attended the School of Hard Knocks since I started work when I was 16. I'm a resident of Stockholm, and I'm usually known around the community for doing all the LAN parties in Sweden. I've been doing DreamHack, RickSack, OptiHack, Assembly, Crank Party, and all those things for a very long time. Doing network engineering. So I speak quite a lot here in the Nordic region, and usually I speak for Nordnet, which people may or may not know, which is some kind of carrier that is serving the RNE needs for Scandinavia. So that means the local NRENs for all the Scandinavian countries and a few of our friends, for example, the Dutch and the Polish NREN. We are AS2603. We're serving from California to Hong Kong. We operate 100 gig DWDM over Europe, and we do lease or swap 100 gig continentally in the US and Asia. We do have a few POPs, so we do have some edge capacity. We also try to do more services than just pure networking, and we share the same engineering operational department as SUNET, and contrary to popular beliefs, we're one of the best carriers in the world, despite what Level 3 and Entity says, and TLA maybe. TDC as well. But we're not here to talk about this, but that is the backstory on why I'm usually representing Nordnet. But today I'm here representing SUNET, because as I said, we share the same engineering department, both of us, so we work at both networks. So SUNET in a nutshell, we're the Swedish NREN. We've been around since the 80s, as long as Nordnet essentially. We do run a network, which is in this generation called the SUNET-C. We do have an identity federation called SVAMID, which is a quite big identity federation. Everyone at the universities uses that. We do have a few users, mainly universities and university colleagues. We serve the most obvious ones, of course. We do serve student dormitories and ISPs serving dormitories. It's not they're not direct customers to us. We do have art colleges, Royal Library, governmental central museums, some other organizations with research activities like the Space People up in Kiruna. We do have governmental entities with special needs, for example, the one that rigs the election, but that arranges the election. Freudian slip there. But they have very specific needs, like they need a lot of bandwidth every fourth year, so which is hard, like a commercial thing to do, so we do it for them. We have an MOU with the National Archives to provide bandwidth and also system administration. And we connect all supercomputers in Sweden and most of all of Scandinavia. Of course, the equivalent of DAIC or Forskningsnet here in Denmark. So, last year we built a new network. We actually started it 1 year before, but we actually started to build January 2016. When we put down the shovels in the ground, not actual shovels, but we started to connect this network together. So what we have is we have a dark fiber network spanning all the way up from Narvik in Norway down to actual Copenhagen, because we do have a fiber over the bridge as well to get onto the internet through Nordnet South. Before we only had a Nordnet and SUNET interchange point in Stockholm, but now we have it also in Copenhagen. So there's a lot of Swedish traffic now exiting through Copenhagen, which is, that's how it is. So what we have is that we want to build a really redundant network. Our customers are very sensitive to downtime, of course, since we are they are single home behind SUNET, and SUNET is also single home behind Nordnet. So we need to build a very redundant network. So we have three routes going all the way out through Sweden. Sweden is, we divided Sweden into four different regions, and every region has triple redundancy, and then there is redundancy within that region itself for dark fiber. We do have three core POPs in Sweden, and we also have, of course, customers that doesn't sit on our core POPs, then we try to arrange that with commercial capacity or hired wavelengths or something else. But that's usually very, very small institutions, so that's not a problem. We also, when we built this network, we also had the possibility to convert all our amplifier sites in a very easy way to a drop site, if that would ever be needed for some reason. So our fiber plan is mostly aerial in high voltage power lines. That means a few things. That means that it's very little, there's not that much outages, but when we have an outage, it's usually very long. Because to repair a fiber that sits in a high voltage power line, you need to take down the power line, and they cannot do that. They cannot do it if it's too cold, cannot do it if it's too windy, they cannot do it if it's too hot. So usually the estimation of repair is about 2 weeks on a fiber like that. A fiber in the ground could be replaced much, much quicker. But we won't have that much outages though. Maybe we have five big ones a year or something like that for the backbone links. Whereas only in the old network we had, which was purely underground, we had much more outages, but shorter outages. We were quite picky when we did the tender. We needed O3R and attenuation data on every single span. We also needed KMC data for every single span. This is to make sure that the vendor, in this case is Tele2 that provides the dark fiber, it's not Tele2 only, but we have the contract directly with Tele2, and then Tele2 has 100 contracts with the subcontractors for all the links. And why we needed the KMC data is that because we really want to know where the fiber goes, so we can make sure that all fiber paths is never crossing each other, and also making sure that they're never closer than 10 meters from each other. When they go, like for example, into a city, we need to make sure that they're spread apart. So with proper KMC data, which is essentially Google Earth, data, we will be very sure that these fibers does not collide with each other. We also have access fiber, and this is completely different thing because access fiber is usually from city networks. I'm not sure how it works in Denmark, but in Sweden, all of them suck. They have no competence. They don't really care about the fiber. As long as there's some kind of light passing through the fiber, it's okay. It doesn't matter if there's like a patch that you get like 5 dB loss in a patch. They were like, it works. There's light here. It's good. And also, they have no clue about KMC data. They have no idea where the fiber goes. They were like, it lies here on the road, maybe. So we couldn't get that. We wanted it, of course, so we specified it in the tender that we would like to have this, but there was no one that could answer on that, right? So we had to actually scrap that out from the tender to even be able to buy something. But the only thing we could do, though, which they actually can guarantee, is to have two separate paths to the big universities. So usually we have one direct route, and then we have one route that goes all the way through the city to get full redundancy inside the city. Speaking about the fiber tender, the fiber tender was finished, I think it was December 2015, maybe January 2016, I'm not sure. Since we know what's required from the fiber plan to build a 100 gig DW network today, that is very easy. Any vendor can tell you what to do. But we also happen to know what you need for 200 gig and 400 gig and above that, right? So we did put out a few requirements for this. For example, that reflection is very important for us. So we only allow minus 42 dB of reflection, of back reflection in fiber. And this is because we're going to come to that, but due to Ramon amplifiers, that needs a very low amount of reflection. We also want measurement of water peak. There's also slides on this on why this is important for us. When we had this the first time, most fiber providers, they were like, are you stupid? Why do you ask for this? No one has asked for this ever. But now they know, so we have this. We want O3R measurements, both short pulse and long pulse, and we'll come also to why that is important. And we also want all connectors to pass this IEC test. This is a standard test to make sure that the connector is clean. This was also a new requirement that no one has ever heard about when we asked for this. And since they were very hesitant on this, we required proof that So this network is consisting of a few thousand connectors, of course. So we required proof of pictures on every connector, which made a few field engineers, a bit rustled regimes. We need equal spacing between sites, so we don't have so we can have as less site as possible or as little site as possible. We need a splice plan and the usual stuff. Right. So as we're going to come back to this, but first we need to speak about this, which TDC and Juniper spoke about here earlier. It's the same thing, right? I'm not going to go into to depth on this. That instead of having an external transponder shelf, you put the transponder directly in the router to be able to get rid of a whole little box. And if you're really lucky, you can also get rid of the people usually running those boxes and only run with the IP engineers. That's a good tip for TDC people, right? that you probably don't need a transport department and an IP department. You only need a transport department which consists of IP engineers. But what do I know? I'm not an optical engineer, so. But yes, of course, all these things that we lower the capex, we buy less boxes, we get less complexity, we don't have to buy the gray optics in the router and all that stuff. Good stuff. The only thing we have, which is a bit unique, is that this network is gridless. That means we have no muxes anywhere. So the whole network is just one big optical collision domain, which means that when we have a coherent optic and we plug it into the DWDM system, we choose the wavelength for it. It's not the mux that chooses the wavelength it should be. So it can be any wavelength at any time. Because the difference between one of those coherent is that it's a coherent receiver and a coherent transmitter. So it works as an FM radio, right? It tunes into the correct wavelength, and they don't care about the rest of the wavelengths. So, for example, on all the routers, they probably get like 15 wavelengths in on the optic, but they only listen to the one they're supposed to listen to. Which that was not possible on like regular 10 gig DWDM optics because they have a wide receiver, so they listen on everything. But these only listen to a very specific thing. So gridless is quite cool for a few things, because since we're not depending on a fixed mux system, then if we need to change wavelength, we don't need to do a physical reconnection. We just need to change the wavelength inside the optics, and we're done. And this doesn't sound that cool, but what you could do though is if you have an outage somewhere on a dark fiber path, which you had through the ROADMs, you map up a path through the ROADMs that it should go this way, and a fiber breaks, and for us, I mean, if it's in the middle of the winter, if the fiber breaks in January, then we could get the reply back that, yeah, we're gonna fix this in March. So it's like, but we kinda need the capacity, right? So what we could do is that we retune the optics, and we build a new path through the network that goes on another route, and we don't need to go at a physically change that to new wavelengths, because we can just change them directly inside the routers. Which is quite cool. There's also a few other cool things with gridless. I guess the most useful thing is that you can build super channels, usually on a classic, I call them legacy DWDM to annoy a few people. So in legacy DWDM networking, you have the fixed filter, which is a 50 gigahertz spacing typically, maybe you have 100 gigahertz spacing. So if you need to run a bigger channel, for example, when you come with a 1 terabit transponder, that would probably be like a, 185 gigahertz channel. It can't fit, right? The hole is too small. But with a gridless system, you decide yourself how big your windows is going to be, so you can run super channels. And we have some calculations in the back of the slide deck, how big are these channels going to be in the future? Because I think that 100 gig and a bit of 200 gig is going to be the last time we do this fixed 50 gigahertz windows. In the future, we need to be more flexible. That's also why gridless is sometimes also called flex grid. Also, gridless is cool because you can also do small channels, right? I mean, 100 gig DPQPSK signal today isn't actually 50 gigahertz, it's 35.7. So you can actually squeeze the channels even tighter together and with a flexible grid, so you can actually fit 120 wavelengths on top of a single fiber. So that's pretty cool. But we need to speak a little about equipment, unfortunately. So we had on DWDM side, because we bought the DWDM and the routed network at the same time, so we're using ADVA FSP 3000, and we only buy amps and ROADMs. They're gridless and colorless. So that contract is quite small, because these are all very basic things. Also, all of this stuff has been around forever. So these are old equipment per se. So quite cheap as well. Advo of course wanted to sell transponders, but we already had them because we bought Juniper MX and one port 100 gig DWDM interface. And we need to speak a little bit about that and also why it differs from the PTX one we saw before. So we're speaking a little bit about FEC here, as Julian had about soft decision FEC. And depending on how deep you wanna go into this rabbit hole, there's a few things to know. So soft decision FEC, SD FEC, is typically proprietary, or it is proprietary. It's a secret sauce, and everyone does their own little thing. Juniper doesn't make their own soft decision FEC. They hire a company called Acacia, which are the biggest, they're like the Broadcom of optical networking. So they bought it from Acacia, and so it's should be interoperable with everyone else that uses Acacia, but that might not be true. And all the DWDM vendors, the legacy ones, like Infinera, like Sienna, Fujitsu, Coriant, Advo even, all of those, they cook their own soft decision FEC in-house, and none of them are compatible with each other. Then you also have something which is very dear to me personally, which is the high gain FEC, or the staircase FEC, or the Cortina FEC, which is unproprietary stuff. So this is released to the public, and because it was a company called Cortina, which also tried to compete with Acacia, but they were not able to because they were too small, and then they were bought by Infy. So they release their SD FEC, or not their SD FEC, but their version of FEC, which is a high gain FEC, which is quite crude, it's quite simple, it's quite cheap to build chips around it. It's also not as good as soft decision FEC, but it's usually good enough for most people. We have run the high gain FEC on about 1,500 kilometers, which are like, I don't know, is that like four round trips through Denmark? So that is. Good enough for metro, right? I just called Denmark a metro, I realized, but 1500 kilometers is okay-ish, right? It can be used for on a few occasions. If you need to go submarine, or if you need to go really long distance, then unfortunately a proprietary solution is what you need to look for. But what is cool with this high-gain FEC thing is that we have a few friends over at Deutsche Telekom in the TerraStream project, which are doing a lot of work also in the telecom infra project with interoperability. Because no one wants to go and buy only Juniper routers and can never connect anything else to it. Might work out from a commercial point of view, but from a spiritual point of view, it's good if your network can have different vendors in it. And TerraStream is one of those networks that requires that you need multiple vendors. So they have this high-gain FEC interoperability between the four big vendors. In this case, it's Cisco, Juniper, Nokia, previously in Alcatel, and Huawei. So they do 100 gig between all those on a high-gain FEC. So that's pretty cool. We also have a GFEC, which is really, really bad. It works only very, very short distance. But it does work and it should be interoperable, but I don't think many people actually tries that one out. So speaking about the DWDM interop, so we have a few things which are non-compatible other than within itself. For example, the PTX 5K PIC we heard about, both the old and the new one. The first one is not confirmed, but I think it's a Clarify DSP in that one. Clarify is also another vendor that made these DSPs, competitor with Acacia. So from the specs, it looks like it's a Clarify. Maybe Julia will tell us later when it's drunk what's actually inside there. But I think it's a Clarify. The new one should be an Acacia, and then we have both the Cisco NCS and the Arista 7500, which are the big chassis switches. They have these DWDM cards to do DCI, and those are both Clarify as far as I know. And why they're Clarify is because time to market. They were quite early on these high density cards. Legacy DWDM vendors, of course, runs proprietary protocols. Like a Sienna can't never talk with Infinera. That will never happen in 1,000 years. But things that is compatible, though, is, for example, the Juniper MX, which I talked about earlier. It does have the Acacia SD FEC, and it also does the high gain FEC, so it can speak, to the Cisco ASR, which is here below. I think this is called a Lightbeak card, which is quite a massive card because it's a 2 port 100 gig and 20 10 gigs. So it's I think it's a bit too big card. Would be nicer with a smaller card to open the business up for more smaller companies. But these two boxes talk to each other with DWDM, as well as the Huawei 2x100 gig. So they have a homebrew SDFEC because Huawei have their own R&D for optical. But they also included the high gain FEC and Alka Nokia, whatever they call nowadays, also has 2x100 gig card, which is also homebrew and high gain FEC. Then we have something that I think is going to change the market quite a lot, and that is the Acacia pluggable CFP2 DCO. So the one before, as I said, it's called the ACO. And why is it called ACO? Because it's an analog coherent, which means that the DSP does not sit inside the transceiver. It needs a very specific line card with a DSP in it to be able to work. So it's not an integrated solution in that case. So it needs to sit in a specific transceiver, it needs to sit in a specific card to work. But with a DCO, which is a digital coherent, then we're starting to get close what we had on 10 gig, right? When we have colored 10 gig optics, that everything needed to build a link is inside the plug. So that is coming to the market. I hope this summer we will see. I have tried them out and they work, and they work really good. So these are going to change the market quite a bit because they have this SDFEC mode, so you can run them. Because also this high gain FEC is only for 100 gig. But these optics is actually 200 gig optics. So they can be 100, 150, and 200. So in 200 gig mode, you need soft decision FEC to be able to go the distance. And then you need a similar one on the other side, unfortunately, because the standardization, the people that cared about standardization kind of missed the boat on the 200 gig thing. So nothing ever got produced for 200 gig in terms of interoperability. So I guess we have to live with that and aim for 400 gig interoperability instead. Because I know the people that drove a lot of the high gain FEC standardization, it's back on track again on 400 gig. So, but this means that a lot of legacy platforms and also a lot of platforms that doesn't, for example, like small vendors, which doesn't have the power like Cisco and Juniper has to make R&D, to make software, to make all these things happen with a DWDM interface, they can just buy the plugs directly. So they can have any CFP2 card should be or might be compatible with these new type of optics if the software supports it. We can assume that, for example, Cisco, Juniper, Arista, Nokia, and Huawei, they will support it probably immediately because they have already written the software to control a coherent optic because they made these analog cards. Now they're making digital cards, so it shouldn't be that much change. Also, it's the same vendor as they used before, which is Acacia. And then you have the Facebook Voyager, which is a project from the Telecom Infra project as well, which is also trying to be this open kind of thing. That is also using Acacia DSPs and high gain FEC including in it. We'll see. There's no software support for high gain FEC yet, but maybe we'll see. It depends a little bit on Facebook, actually, what you want to do. Coriant and Adva also have, which are two smallish DWDM vendors, also nowadays have transponders which speak high gain FEC. And hopefully more future products so we get interop. Because on Ethernet, it's no one would accept that you have Cisco Ethernet and Juniper Ethernet. That's unacceptable, right? Everything needs to work together. So we need to go there as well in terms of optical. It's going to take some time, but we need to go there. But there is a quite, pushback from the market, or not from the market, but from the vendors. Like the legacy vendors, Ciena and Infinera especially, the two biggest ones, they don't want to see this happen, right? Because that means less money for them. Usually they've been protected by this a little bit because they have made much, much better optics than anyone else. So they have always been able to say that our quality is so much better, we can shoot much further with much higher density, with smaller boxes, blah, 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 all the things for quite a long time, and that was true. And they still say it, but it's not actually true anymore. You can build very dense, very high performing, very scalable solutions today with third party things. So they need to compete on even terms now, which they don't like. Right, so that was a lot of things about optical. So now we need to speak about something interesting. That was not the interesting slide though. So we have a few routers. We use mainly the 480s as CPEs. We use 960 as small core pop, and then we have the 2010 and 2020 as big core routers. We bought 35 of these Rodem chassis and about 100 amplifiers for Sweden. And we might as well have built this with Cisco or Huawei or Nokia. They have the same things, but turns out that it was Uniper this time. Can we actually see this? I'm not sure. So it's some kind of optical design. So all these blue boxes are Rodems. And these cities here are all university cities in Sweden. So there's a university in all of these cities in some way. We also have a path up to Norway, and that is to provide backup connectivity for Norway. Because Norway is a very thin country in the middle, right? So it has happened a few times that it actually got cut off in the middle. So Norway got split into two halves. So that's why we provide a backup path that goes from Narvik, which is very, very far up north. We run it through the network, and we take it to Stockholm so they can run redundancy over Sweden. And we also have down here in Malmö and Copenhagen, where we also have fiber. So how we did this thing, this is not a very good slide because to resolution, but this is actually the same thing, but it's more zoomed up. So how we built this thing, right, is that somewhere in the city, in a data center somewhere, it could be a secure facility somewhere down in a mountain, it could be a container, it could be somewhere in the basement of a building, whatever there is, we put a core out there, and we put east and west DWDM, and even a north and a south, depending on how big the node is. But this is a typical east-west solution. We put two different shells, and this site has a lot of requirements. It has to have redundant cooling, it has to have redundant power, it needs backup generators, it needs batteries, of course, and it needs some kind of contract with someone coming up with diesel to refuel the thing. So it's done the correct way, per se. We do have two fibers coming to the site. One is the black one is just regular Ethernet, so that's LR, because this is all pure 100 gig, by the way. We don't do 10 gigs, so we only do 100 gigs. And what we do here is, so from the core router in the city to the R1, which is at the university, which was the 480, we do 100 gig LR4. So this fiber, we had very high requirements on this fiber that this needs to be as good as possible, because LR4 is only 10 kilometers. So we want as good fiber as we could get. And this was possible in all cities except one, where we had to run ER4 to get 40 kilometers of range. We didn't expect that actually. We thought the fiber would have been even worse, but it turns out pretty good. And it goes to the box, and then we build a whole bunch of 10 gig lags in between. And then what we do on the second router, we put a coherent card in it. And we shoot it through the POP, but we don't terminate it into the router. We shoot it through the DWDM, and then we go to the neighboring city. So which means that the university routers pair with two different cities. And this is to save money on buying core routers. Because otherwise, the initial design was to put two core routers in every city to get proper redundancy. But it was actually cheaper to backhaul it over DWDM. And also, these are, of course, redundant fiber paths. So coming back to the talk from TDC there, you need to connect directly into the ROADM. This is quite far, I could say. We have a few paths here which are like 70 kilometers just to get redundancy through the city. So we run them between everything from 7 to 70 kilometers is this dark fiber. So we don't do very short runs. We do quite long runs before we enter the ROADM. And then we have ROADMs, and we have variable amplifiers and a variable attenuator inside a ROADM to equalize the channels. Right, and as you know, in Sweden, quite far country, so this other core router could actually be quite far away. We have, I'm not sure the longest stretch we have here, but it's easily like 400 kilometers on some place. So it's quite spread out. So in terms of logical design, what we do, I guess this is our standard delivery. So we have the university routers again. They are fully controlled by SUNET, and then the campus have some kind of router themselves, and then they pair with eBGP to us. And they choose either a bunch of 10 gigs or 100 gig or a 40 gig as a handoff. Most of them are choosing 10 gig, which is good for us because we really don't want to buy 40 gig, because 40 gig is dead. So at least in the ISP space. So what we do is that we pair with them. They have their own ACE number. They have their own layer, all that good stuff. So that's how we did it before. Actually, on the SUNET 2 generations ago, everyone had this handoff. But since the last generation of SUNET, which was a 10 gig network, they kind of didn't want to buy routers at the university. They don't want to run BGP. They don't want to do any of that stuff because that costs money, and university doesn't have any money, or not that much money anymore. So what we did in the last generation is that we used something called a logical system inside the Juniper routers, is that you split the routers in two routers, so that they could run their own core network inside our equipment. Because we have a very friendly relationship with our customer, because, I mean, we're the same people, right? So what we did is that, yeah, we split it into two, and we took a logical system ourselves, and we gave away the main instance to the university. Because these MX routers, they're quite potent, so they could do anything a usual university campus network would like to do. They can, of course, do it. They can do MLAG, they can do VXLAN. On a university, probably one spanning tree and those kind of things. You could probably do that as well. I'm not sure. So what they did is that usually they try to decommission if they have some like Cisco 6500 or something, and they are end of everything, right? They're end of support, end of life, end of whatever. So they usually replace those with our logical system because it's provided for free because it doesn't cost anything. So if it doesn't cost us anything, it doesn't cost them anything. So we gave away that stuff, and what they do is that we have VLANs on the uplink port, so they pair with the core. And the reason why they don't pair with the SUNET instance locally is because then traffic needs to loop through the ASIC twice. So we actually get better performance if we let them pair with the core instead, using the logical system, or sorry, using the main instance themselves. And the reason why we run a logical system is that because we do run other services to the university. For example, we have a few new universities, they do backups to each other. So what we do is that University 1 has backup to University 2, but they do this over Layer 2. So then we transport it with either VXLAN or MPLS, depending on what we feel like. So that's why we have a logical system of our own, so we can do, first we need our own IBGP, we need MPLS, we do ISIs to that system. On another VLAN on the uplink port, so we can terminate those kind of things that doesn't directly concern the university. And this is working surprisingly well, and I would say that about 60% of the connected SUNET customers are currently using this model of connecting, because they get two free core routers, which is quite nice. So now we're going to go back to the optical things again and be boring. So there's something called a Raman amplifier. People have probably heard about the EDFA amplifier. EDFA amplifiers works as an amplifier. You take in a low signal in one direction, and you pump it up, and then you have a better signal on the other end. A Raman amplifier works the exact opposite way. So a Raman amplifier pumps in tons of light in the TX direction, so it actually shoots it in the wrong way, for example. So it shoots light in its receive direction, right? So it's from CD1 to CD2. You have a Raman amplifier in CD2. It shoots light in the receive direction from CD1, and that is because it uses this light to excite the other to act as a carrier for the light. And you do this to get better OSNR, and you need better OSNR to be able to run higher bandwidth channels. And we optimized the network for high OSNR, so we bought a lot of Raman amplifiers. The thing with Raman amplifiers, why they matter, or why they're different from EDFA, is first, they're extremely sensitive to reflection, because some of they launch at like plus 15, so they're extremely sensitive. If they get blinded, it's essentially, so if it's a lot of reflection, it will get blinded, like if you look into the sun. And then they shut down, because then they protect themselves by shutting themselves down, and then they don't work. So you because they cost quite a lot of money, right? So let's say they cost 10k euro maybe, and if you get zero value out of it, that's 10k down the drain. So you really need them to work, and we do this to prepare for 400 gig and 1 terabit, because we already know what's going to be needed for 400 gig and 1 terabit, because that is just physics. Even though I didn't attend school, I looked up physics on Wikipedia, and it made sense. Right. So the problems we have with Ramones is a few things. So this is a regular O3R section. It's a fiber that seems to be 100 kilometers long. Looks pretty okay, probably up to standard. No problem here. I think most ISPs would be fine with this O3R. But if we go back a few slides ago, we said that we also wanted a short pulse and a long pulse. And we wanted a short pulse because, as I said, reflection early for a Ramon amplifier is really, really bad, right? So this, is, as you can see, is directly on the site, and we have 1, 2, 3, it's actually 4, 5, 6 different things happening in the first 50 meters. And this, I know because I did this myself, this is a stretch where the Ramon doesn't boot. It shuts itself off immediately when it detects this, because there's too much reflection. And this is because this is probably a patch, and maybe a splice. So we have to cut that down significantly. For example, we could take some war stories directly. So we have Telenor bought a company called Utfors, which was one of those power/grid companies that did a lot of fiber in Sweden. And they did a really good job of building sites out in the forest. They built really cool sites with flexible roomings. So there's a lot of small rooms, and then they have meet me rooms. So all these little boxes inside the site could connect to each other. So it's essentially like a proper big data center, like an interaction, but it's outside in a forest in a container with proper MMRs. So that's really good to have it like that kind of flexibility, but not for us. Because having those local MMRs inside a site creates this. It creates a whole lot of patches, which is not good for us since we run Ramon amplifiers. So what we had to do on a lot of places is we needed to install bypass fibers so that we have just one patch that goes directly in our amplifier and then goes to the line ODF. Also usually these internal MMRs inside the sites are usually UPC connectors, the blue ones. And UPC is not good if you want low reflection. You want APC, which are the green polish ones, which are the angle connectors. They are much better for optimizing for good reflection. So we had to do that on a lot of places, essentially all Utfors sites. We had to install this to pay someone to install these bypass fibers to get this down to a good level. This is one of our best connectors in the network when we got it. So all of them look like this, right? So I have some pictures later in the deck on what that could do to our network. This is usually what we want. So this is from a fiber microscope, and we realized very, very early, actually before the tender was finished, that shit, we need to do something about all this bad fiber, right? So we put in the IEC test as a must-have inside the tender, that we need proof that every connector is passing this test. Did it do it? Of course not. But did we enforce it? Yes, of course we did. So there was a lot of disgruntled Ericsson and Eltel engineers driving around in Sweden to weird cabin in the forest polishing connectors. That was have this water peak effect, which, as I said, that people were dumbfounded when we started to ask about this. So this is two different O3Rs and two different fibers. This is the O3R, which is made with four different wavelengths. Usually when you do O3R, you do it 1550 and 1310 maybe, which are the like common wavelengths to do O3R with. But we also had a weird that we wanted to do with 1383, and we also wanted to do O3R with something in the L band, which is above the C band. And why this matter is because this is one of the wavelengths that the Ramon amplifier use. So a Ramon amplifier shoots out four wavelengths, and they should perform as they should. So they should perform like this, right? That of course you have much more attenuation on 1310 than on 1550. That is, again, how physics works, apparently. So it should look like this, and this is essentially if you look inside the Ramon, I would not recommend you looking inside the Ramon amplifier, but if you would have done it, it would have looked like this. But some fiber, I think it's fiber that is made between 91 and 95 or something like that, had like a degradation. All of them had it, because that's how you made fiber back in the days. So on, you have a big peak, which is called the water peak, on 1383, which can be seen here. So this is actually the 1383 wavelength, which dies much, much earlier than the other ones. So on a Raman amplifier, it could look like you get, for example, a Raman amplifier reports back to the NMS that, yes, I'm currently operating on a 13 dB gain level. And then you do some calculations on the physics things, and you learn, all right, then I should have this type of optical performance. But if you have a degradation like this on the fiber, then you will actually not notice that you don't get that performance upgrade that you wanted. So there's nothing we can do about this, but we need to know it, which was the reason why we required that inside the tender. All right, assumptions, or maybe facts, depending on how you look at it. I think we should go with assumptions. So since, as I said, we built this network for 400 gig and beyond, because our fiber tender was on 15 years, or it's 10 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, so at least 10 years, but up to 15. We also put the ROADM and the amplifiers on an unusual long payoff period, because they are quite stupid equipment, so it's probably not that much that's going to change on that on that market. However, the client interfaces and the routers, they are much shorter lived, so we put them on a shorter time to pay. So, as I said, we want to run these cool 400 gig wavelengths, not because we might need it, but because it's cool. So we need to figure out, can our network do this? Because that's why we built it in the first place. So we did if we do this, we will probably do it between Gothenburg, Stockholm, Malmö, in this classic triangle, right? The three big cities in Sweden, to build a super core on top of it. So we have a few estimations about OSNR in the network. And Gothenburg, Malmö is one of the best ones, because higher here is better. And then we did some math. We looked up math on Wikipedia, how math works. And we tried to figure out, all right, how far can we run on the channels? So Malmö, Stockholm, which is quite far, because we go through a few ROADMs, and this is quite a hefty stretch. That's probably, I don't know, 900 kilometers or something. So we do run 100 gig QPSK today. We've been running that for 9 months, work perfectly, no problem, with 32 gigabaud. And we could probably run 150 as well. If we go up to 43 gigabaud, and now we come into the FlexiGrid stuff, because 43 gigabaud needs more spectrum. So we can't fit it in a 50 gigahertz grid. As well as 64 gigabaud doesn't fit either, because that wavelength is wider. So we will not be able to do 400 gig from the looks of it on our current network. And how we're going to solve this is usually by installing more Raman amplifiers. Maybe do a full stretch of Raman amplifiers to get the OSNR up a bit, because Raman helps with OSNR quite a lot. But you don't get that much from every hop, so we probably need it on every hop to get to the point where we have maybe an OSNR of like 22 or something. We did some math on Stockholm, Gothenburg as well, which is a bit shorter. But we will still not be able to run 400 gig, 16 QAM, 64 gigabaud. That is not going to work. So we need more amplifiers and tighter sites as well. So that's something we're going to put on the long plan in terms of improvement. Gothenburg, Malmö, though, has much better fiber, and it's a bit shorter. So there we actually have OSNR that's good enough to be able to run 400 gig all the way between Gothenburg and Malmö. So we don't need to do that much more on those paths, at least. And right, back to the fun stuff again. So this is a very typical site. Since most of the network is run in high power lines, the sites are usually on the substations, I think it's the English word for it. So this, as you can see, there is the power grid is in the back, and it's a regular container. And these are quite small containers. Oh, that's the generator, whatever. So these are quite small containers, and we want to put quite big routers inside of them. And on a Juniper 960, taking out the power supply, you almost need a full, because you flip the power supplies down on a 960. So you actually need quite a lot of space behind the router to be able to operate the router. So we need to figure that one out. And the site is quite small. So what we did is that all racks sets on these slide bearings to be able to drag the whole rack out so you can change power supplies. Otherwise, you would have need to dismount it. That was the initial plan, actually, that, all right, how often does the power supply break on a router? Is it okay, like once a year, going to a site, shut down the router, unscrew it, change the power supply, screw it back in, and then we started to look at RMA statistics, and then we're like, nope, we're not going to do that. We need something else. So we put the racks on sliding wheels, and to be able to have cables not snap off every time, we have these cable chains. All sites are DC powered, by the way. So we have DC power, and we have fibers coming into this black one, and we have grounding coming in, so they can slide along. And this is about 158 kilo of people, which is also the same weight of a 960. And the blacksmith that did, because we actually ordered this from a blacksmith, he made them really good. It puts in some really good bearing. So you could actually move this rack with people with just fingers. You can just like so he did a really good job on that. So we can slide the rack back and forth to be able to change power supplies. And I guess one cool thing that we did is that, first, we are very few people. I mean, we're four engineers, and we're five people in the NOC, and that's about it. And the country is quite big, so we needed to do something smart. So what we did is, for example, I'm not sure if I have a picture on the ROADMs, but it's quite a lot of internal cabling on a ROADM. There's small cables going back and forth all the time, and you have these supervisor channels. So it's essentially all the cabling on a ROADM is internal cabling, and then you only have the line fiber coming in. So what we did is, when we ordered the ROADMs, we ordered them pre-cabled, so they come from factory with cables in them. And the only thing that field engineers had to do was to connect the line cables for east and west. And that was about it. And on every site, we also put in this little open gear console server, which has a 4G SIM in it. So since we bought a bunch of 4G SIMs from Tele2, and they installed a 4G antenna on every site. So we could just take the little antenna with a little RP-SMA connector, put it inside the open gear console, and then we connected both the router and the ADVA ROADM through that console, and then we called into the site with a 4G VPN to be able to configure it. So everything was unconfigured from the factory, and we did everything from the office only with 4G. Because it's quite a difference in terms of money and also in terms of how good engineers you can get. If you only want people installing the router, putting electricity in it, that's quite cheap, and you can get it from quite a lot of different vendors, like Eltel, Relacom, Ericsson, Telia, maybe even TDC does it. I'm quite sure TDC actually does it. But getting people to also configure the router, to configure the ROADM, to equalize paths in the amplifiers, that's a lot more expensive. So that's what we did. We replaced a lot of people with a 4G modem, which is kind of a thing. So I actually recommend. I usually don't recommend vendors, but I can actually recommend this box. It's been really nice to work with. It's a Linux, runs Linux in it, and very, very flexible. So open gear is the shit. A few words about management, especially for the optical part. So Wave is provisioned using GMPLS right now, which runs inside the ADVA network. The ADVA NMS supports the Juniper MX interfaces, so they actually show up as an alien transponder, and they can control the transponder if we wanted to. The thing is, we hate those NMSs, right? I mean, if you ever work with a DWDM NMS, you quite early see that all of them suck. All of them are worthless piece of shit software that you want to try to get rid of. So what we want to do instead, that ADVA has in the tender promised that they will do NetConfYang, and NetConfYang is the answer to life and universe and everything. So that would be great, because, I mean, we don't configure the Juniper router with the CLI anymore because that's way too slow. So we try to do it with Jang models and push it over NetConf. So we want this to happen as well with AdvaNMS. So we can deinstall this old Solaris server or whatever it is, and only speak. We use Cisco NSO to provision, by the way. So we can use that one to provision the ROADMs and wavelengths as well, maybe. So time for some more war stories. So we used the one port MIG3 DWDM, has worked really good. We have been running it on spans that is 2,300 kilometers with SDFEC. We can probably push out a few kilometers more on that if you wanted to, because we looped this around. So we took it from Narvik and then we looped it through Copenhagen and back up to Gothenburg again. And that has been working good. So it actually works better than specifications. And I tried all of the other vendors' DWDM things, Cisco's Lightbeak card, Huawei's card, and Nokia's card, and all of them usually performs better than what you specify to do. I guess that the IP vendors doesn't wanna, what can you say? They don't wanna brag about being the one to shoot the longest, because that's Ciena and Infinera's business. They can do that. So that's really good. So that's a happy face on that. That seemed to be performing quite well. However, fiber sites. So we have at least three destroyed Ramanams, and three destroyed Ramanams. That's about the same cost as a pretty nice car. So only due to fat residue on fibers. Because if there's too much fat, that you get a little gap when they put in the fiber, and then the Raman tries to start, it emits light on about plus 18. So, and the fat actually burns, so it burns inside the connector, and then it welds it together. So that you actually have to like snap the connector out, and then the Raman is broken. And this is only because some dude is irresponsible with cleaning the fiber. So we had to change three of those. We had, when we got the network, when it was delivered as ready, we opened 94 tickets on 132 spans. And almost all of those problems were fixed with cleaning or changing patches, which is, I don't know. We had a few near-death experiences. We're going to show pictures on that later. And then we need to discuss some Juniper. So we had about 10% dead on arrival, or very close to arrival. That's on the MPC3. They either was dead when we got them out of the box, or they died within 3 weeks. But it got changed, so it was sorted. We don't have that much more problems with them anymore, but it delayed the rollout quite a bit because we were on a very tight schedule to roll out because we did this in 5 months, so we had to everything had to work right. And these DWDM cards, it doesn't run on any Junos. You essentially need service release or these F releases. They have been a complete mess to us. We have at least run 8 different versions of Junos in the network for the last 9 months. And now we're decently stable on something called S3. We were hoping to get to S4 quite soon. We use the NextGen REs. So those are the Linux REs. So they run Linux on them, and they run Junos in KVMs. They have been decently messy. We had a lot of small bugs. For example, we didn't have LEDs on the boxes, so they didn't look that like they were on, which was quite irritating. You had to listen to it if it was on. We had on the MX2020, it was actually the same bug, but when we booted up the MX2020, it presented itself as MX2010, and that took quite a lot of time to figure out why it was like that, because it appeared as soon as we applied our standard configuration, then it downgraded itself to MX2010. And turns out that the communication between these VMs, it's done on 192.168.1.0/24. That is the internal communication network between the REs. And we, of course, have that network firewalled out in our standard configuration. So that's why the upper half and the lower half of the MX2020 couldn't talk to each other. So they operated as two MX2010s, which was kind of like, what? But that took a long time to figure out. But it was solved with editing the firewall filter on the RE, the loopback zero filters. We had a lot of next hop corruption. All of them are solved now, so that's good. Loss of signal alarm handling has been shaky. We had a lot of chassis alarms that didn't do anything, like it triggered a chassis alarm. Everything worked fine, but no one knows why it was we got this major errors on the chassis. So that is also solved now. We still have an active case where these REs swap around for no apparent reason. It works. They do graceful routing between each other, but they swap for no apparent reason. So we're trying to solve that. And also one of the bigger, that was quite early in the network when that was, I'm not sure if that was a bug or just not really thinking the correct way, when you brought up a new card and it, you wanted it to tune, it did a sweep and then it like tuning the wavelength and it's like, now I'm the correct wavelength. And this doesn't really matter in a network where you have muxes, but since we run gridless, then we have a huge problem. So what it did is that it shoot down the whole network. Whoops. It shot down the whole network because it tried to do every wavelength. And that's not good if you run gridless. So that got fixed quite fast. Some more interesting things. So this is from the boot sequence on one of these next generation REs. So it tries to boot postfix for some reason. So it's a quite rough implementation of Linux on the REs. We also have a few interesting things that it doesn't find the drivers for ALSA. So it has a problem with the sound card. I actually tried to fix it by installing a USB sound card. Wait, loopback. But it didn't want to recognize the USB sound card, unfortunately. Because I really wanted to know what the sound on MX-2010 actually wants to give me. Like, does it click or does it, what does it do? So speak of near-death experience. So this was mounted from a subcontractor inside the rack. So these are 63 amp DC feeds, completely unshielded. So this is inside the rack. So when I opened it and I started to put in things, I was like, whoop, I don't want to touch this stuff. Because if you touch one of these copper, these completely unshielded copper ones, you will be totally toasted, right? So you don't want to do that. So that had changed. This was also quite a big problem we had when we went around and did measurements. Congestion. And if you ever driven around with reindeers, you know that they don't give a shit about you coming with a car. So you actually need to go out and kick them. Because you can shout at them. The only good thing would have been to bring a rifle, because that is the only thing that they're actually afraid of. But I didn't bring my guns, so that was a bit unfortunate. And since I only have 3 minutes more time, I have questions.
Anybody for questions?
Yeah, of course, yeah, I kick them, punch them in the face.
I have a question. You said you have fiber over power lines.
Yes.
How high voltage was those power lines?
The power lines, I believe, in Sweden are 400,000 volts, I believe. So they're usually, fiber is usually either it's spun around it.
The reason I'm asking is when you are in lower voltage, your fiber will get errors in the wind. That was the question about
right.
if it is windy also, if you see more errors on that fibers.
Yes, yeah. So we have done a lot of measurement on that when it's bad weather, right? So you usually get a higher, you get a lot of more, you need to do a lot of more compensation for chromatic dispersion, because when the fiber swings around in the top line, you see that, because we actually built a tool, we got help with one of the university that actually know physics. So they helped us building a tool that measure chromatic dispersion. So we have that inside the network all the time. And we can see as soon as there's a storm or there's bad weather, we see that those values go up. But all these optics are actually quite good on compensating for chromatic dispersion. So the first generation MX we saw here, that does 40,000 picoseconds per meters, I think is the correct measurement. And that is apparently quite a lot. We have seen it go up on a few long stretches about to like 25,000 picoseconds, and they can compensate for 40,000. So we haven't seen the worst storms yet. So maybe when these, what do you call it, these sandy or these big storms comes in, these type of storms, maybe we have bigger problems. But for now, for the regular storms we had, it looks okay. Hopefully, we'll see. That's also why we built a very redundant network. We can lose any fiber stretch, and it's like, whatever. We can actually lose two at the same time. It's like, whatever.
All right, we have time for one more question, if anybody. All right, give Hugo a big hand. Okay, Hugh is standing there still. That's because we have the next program item is lightning talks, and Hugh has a very short one to start with.
Yes, I have a really, really, really short lightning talk. So we Swedes were quite jealous of DKNOG because we don't have a Swenog. But we had it a long time, many moons ago. We had something called SOF, which was the Swedish Operator Forum, which was something like DKNOG, but also a more close type of meeting stuff, where people sat down and talked business, not business with each other, but talk internet with each other. The last meeting of SOF was held in 2006, and it has been sleeping ever since then. But from this year, we're gonna try a few very dedicated people, hopefully dedicated, is gonna try to reboot SOF. And SOF is a chapter under the Swedish ISOC. So we will try to reboot it, or at least we will try to start it and see if the decision is to continue with it or to kill it definitely, because now it exists in a limbo state. So the organization has, for example, it has money, it has members, it also has, delegate one of the board members to .se or the IIS board, but we haven't done it for 10 years. So we need to decide to either continue with that and maybe it turns into something that resembles DKNOG, we will see. Maybe it turns into something else, depending on the members. But we need to do something proper with it. Either kill it or really start it. And for the Swedes or even the Danes that has some kind of thing happening in Sweden, then this might be something for you. Hopefully, it's going to be by engineers for engineers, and we will hope we will have a good time. Otherwise, we'll kill it, and we will have the first meeting in 10 years directly after the NetNode Days in April. So I think NetNode Days ends at like 3, the second day, and we will continue with this directly after. So there is some backstory and thing on this link. And that was all for me.
I'm looking very much.